Good morning, everybody. It's good to be here with all of you on this beautiful Sunday morning. My name is Zach. I am the worship director here at Bethel, and it's my pleasure to welcome you. If you are a guest or a visitor, a special welcome to you, and a special welcome to all of our online guests this morning. It's good that you've joined us to worship God. In the back of the chairs in front of you, there's a little connect card, and that is for all of you, whether you are a guest, whether this is your home church. That connect card is for you because on the back, if you want to get to know us a little better, there's a spot to write down your information. And on the back, there's also a spot for prayer requests. So if you have a prayer request, we invite you to write it on the back there and then to hand that in. And this morning, we have the privilege of being led in worship by Pastor Kurt, who is the director of Reframe Ministries. And Reframe is a ministry of the Christian Reformed Church. And so they aim to see lives and worldviews of people all over the world transformed by the gospel message through contextual media resources. So Pastor Kurt, I believe you've been there since August 2012. Welcome. We're glad you're here this morning. And I'll invite you up now.
Call to worship this morning comes from Psalm 118, verses 22 through 24. The stone the builders rejected has become the capstone. The Lord has done this, and it is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Please join me for a word of prayer. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for this beautiful summer morning, for your hand in creation. Thank you above all for your love for us, for calling us to be your children gathered around the world, speaking every tongue from every tribe, from every nation. This morning, as we worship here, we reflect your glory and your glory being spread throughout the earth. Please bless our worship service. We ask that the Spirit would empower us, your Spirit would open our hearts so that we can understand who you are and love you and serve you. And we can only do this through the sacrificial gift of love of your Son, Jesus, for us. And it's in his name we pray. Amen. I invite you to stand for God's call to worship this morning, if you're able. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. As God has greeted us this morning, let's take a moment and greet those around us.
Us to love, but we walk away from neighbors in need, wrapped in our own concerns. God of mercy and grace, we repent in spirit and in truth, admit our sin, and gratefully receive your forgiveness through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer. Amen. Hear the good news. God, the Creator, brings you new life, forgives you, and redeems you. In Jesus Christ, we are redeemed and forgiven. Thanks be to God. Thank you.
At this time, I will invite deacons forward to take our collection, our offering for this Sunday. And this week, our giving opportunity is for, actually, it's in-house for the youth ministries that run at Bethel. And if you are a tender of Bethel, you will know that there is lots of youth ministries taking place in these doors in this building from week to week for our youth. And that includes anything from our littlest friends in nursery this morning all the way up to our college and careers aged 20-somethings. So they are appreciative of your giving this morning. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. This is the part of our service where we bless our children. So I will offer up a prayer for all of our kids, and then we will join together to bless them. So if you'll pray with me. Dear Lord, we thank you for this time of worship together this morning, and we thank you for each and every child that you have entrusted to us here at Bethel. We pray that as they head down to Sunday school today, that you would just fill them with a curiosity to learn more about you, to grow closer to you, and to explore what that looks like and what that means. We pray as they continue to attend our Sunday school ministry here that they would grow in both love and knowledge of you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, kids, if you would like to come into the aisles, you are welcome to do that now. Okay, awesome. All right, so you can follow along on the slide if you're new. Are we all ready? Okay, congregation, what is our blessing for these children? Good job, kids. You can head to Sunday school.
Our reading for this morning is Psalm 67. Before we read, shall we go to the Lord in prayer? Father God, thank you for bringing us here this morning. Thank you for welcoming us to worship you, to give you praise and honor and glory. We ask that as we begin to read your word, that you would open our ears and our hearts and our minds so that we can hear what you have to say to us. We ask that you would be with Pastor Kurt, that you would bless him and allow him to share with us the words that you have caused him to prepare, that we could go out this week and do what it is that you would have us do. In Jesus' name, amen. Psalm 67. May God be gracious to us and bless us, and make his face shine on us, so that your ways may be known on earth, and your salvation among all nations. May the peoples praise you, God. May all the peoples praise you. May the nations be glad and sing for joy, for you rule the peoples with equity, and you guide the nations of the earth. May the peoples praise you, God. May all the peoples praise you. The land yields its harvest. God, our God, blesses us. May God bless us still, so that all the ends of the earth will fear him. The word of the Lord.
Good morning. What a beautiful Sunday morning it is. I live in Grand Rapids, Michigan, and I came last night, and it was rainy when I came, but to wake to such a beautiful summer morning is a great joy, and to be able to worship with you and to open God's Word with you is a huge privilege, so thank you for the opportunity to be here this morning. Before I open God's Word with you, looking at Psalm 67, there's a short video that I wanted to play. It's 1 minute and 4 seconds, so it won't take a lot of time. And then I was going to say a word about Reframe Ministries.
In 1 week, have you ever considered how many phone calls you made, articles you read on the internet, emails you sent, hours you listened to the radio or podcasts? For someone looking for answers to life's most important questions, each of those encounters with media can be an opportunity to hear God's story. That's why at Reframe Ministries, we connect individuals and churches with ministry teams around the globe who believe that everyone should have access to God's story. Sharing the good news of the gospel may look and sound different in different contexts, but in all 10 language ministries, we all have the same goal: to share God's story with those who are hurting, those who can't travel to church, or those who are restricted by government rules and even their own family members. Reframe Ministries. God's story, today's media.
There was also a slide that I wanted to show with Reframe on it. Thank you. So let me just say a word about Reframe Ministries. Perhaps you haven't even ever heard of Reframe Ministries. We're the media ministry, the media mission ministry of the Christian Reformed Church. Maybe you haven't heard of Reframe Ministries, but probably you've heard of Back to God Hour or Back to God Ministries International. In 1939, the Christian Reformed Church started the Back to God Hour, a small radio program, but God really blessed that program. And I like to say, put the Christian Reformed Church on the map in North America, in Canada and the United States. God blessed that program. It was about proclaiming the gospel. It was about providing discipleship, information, resources for people who wanted to follow Jesus. It was about connecting people to local churches. God really blessed the Back to God Hour. In the 1940s, the ministry started a daily devotional. It's called the Today Devotional. I saw it out front in the foyer area. Perhaps some of you have used that already this morning. You probably don't know this. We print something like 200,000 of these every other month, but we estimate as many as 500,000 people, 500,000 people use that devotional every day. God's really blessed that ministry as well. One of the dynamic things about our ministry is that in the 1950s, realizing the power of radio, the ministry started an Arabic language ministry to proclaim the gospel in the Middle East. In the 1960s, started a Spanish ministry. In the late 1960s, Japanese, Indonesian, Portuguese. God has really blessed the ministries that we work with in English, but also in 9 other major world languages. God has really blessed this ministry so that we have the opportunity, using media, not just radio, but using all kinds of media, to share the gospel, to help with discipleship, to call people to join local churches in almost every country in the world. God has really blessed this ministry. So many things have changed, including our name, Reframe Ministries, used to be Back to God Hour. Same thing, though. Using lots of different media, using lots of different ways to reach and connect. We've used radio, still use radio. We've used shortwave. We've used television. We use print. More and more we use the internet. More and more we use this, smartphone technology. This is a powerful way to reach into almost every corner in the world. And the great news about Reframe is it's still doing what the founders of Back to God Hour were trying to do in 1939. Proclaim the gospel, help with discipleship, challenge, call people to join local churches. I just want to say thank you this morning for your part in our ministry. Thank you for the ministry shares that you offer. This is a promise that we make together to do things that we can't do individually or as individual congregations. We're working together to share God's love around the world, and it's with your partnership that we're able to do this. So thank you very much for the chance to be here this morning to say something about Reframe Ministries and to just ask you to continue to partner with us through your prayers, through your support. Now I'd like to ask you to do something that probably you don't do every Sunday, and that is take out your phones. If you have a phone with you, and I'm guessing almost everyone here this morning has a phone, please do take it out. And I know you know how to do this because I saw so many QR codes in the loop that was going through at the beginning. I know you know how to scan that, and I know you know that there's a donation page there. But I also want you to know that instead of giving papers, if you, you know, take a picture of this QR code, you'll have lots more information about the ministry. And when you do give and when you do pray, you'll do it in an informative and informed kind of way. So please do take out your phones and take a picture. And when you have a chance, not during the sermon, but when you have a chance later, take a look at Reframe Ministry. So thank you very much for the opportunity to share a little bit about the ministry. Now I'd like for us to turn to God's Word and look at Psalm 67. Some years ago, my wife and I decided to take a camping trip. We were living in Grand Rapids, Michigan, and Vicky, my wife, she's from South Florida. So we thought, let's take a camping trip down to Florida. We won't do it all in one drive. Usually it was 2 days, but we won't do it in 2 days. We'll do it over a week or so. So we loaded up our 1982 Toyota Starlet, tiny little red car. We filled it with our pup tent and our camping gear, and we set off driving south on I-75, I believe it was. First stop we made was Lookout Mountain in Tennessee. I don't know if anybody has been to Lookout Mountain in Tennessee. It's famous for Ruby Falls. We didn't go to Ruby Falls, though. We went there because Vicky had graduated from Covenant College there on Lookout Mountain, and there's a nice state park there. We thought, this is a great place for us to, you know, start our camping trip. So we pitched our little pup tent, and we made a fire. I think we had some hot dogs on sticks, and, you know, we sat down at the table. And one thing I remember so vividly about that camping experience is it was a very dry summer, and for some reason there were lots of bees around, and we were drinking some kind of red bug juice. I don't know if it was Kool-Aid or punch or whatever, and the bees were hovering around our sweet red drink. And unfortunately, one of the bees got into Vicky's shirt and stung her like 7 times down her back. She was in pain. She was in agony. And there was a lot of chaos in our campsite. And the camp ranger came over and he gave us some salve. And I put it on Vicky's back. And things settled down. And we were able to finish our hot dogs. A bit later, we put some s'mores. I think we did this. Some s'mores on the fire and had a nice campfire experience. I don't know what time it was. It wasn't so late. We crawled into our pup tent and went to sleep. A bit later, I think it was probably after midnight sometime, it started to rain. Our tent held up pretty good, but eventually it started to rain harder, and then it was raining even harder, and then it was raining, as they say, cats and dogs. At first, the rain was going like this around our tent, but eventually it came right through our tent, and we were soaking wet. That was in 1986, and Vicki and I have been married almost 40 years now, and I have to say we've done very little camping in our married life. Now you're probably wondering, what in the world is this guy doing talking about a camping experience in the context of Psalm 67? Yeah, we're going to talk about Psalm 67. Do you know why I might choose a camping story to introduce Psalm 67? Because it's a camping psalm. Did you know that? Psalm 67 is associated with Sukkot. It's a fall festival, one of the 3 great Hebrew festivals. And at this festival, it was kind of a harvest festival. So, you know, sometime late September, early October, the people of Israel would come out of their houses. They would go to Jerusalem. They would build tabernacles. They would build shelters. They put some sticks in the ground and then they'd lay branches over it and they camped out for 7 or 8 days. During the day, they would go up to the temple, and it's believed, nobody knows this exactly for sure, but because of the association with the Feast of Tabernacles, it's believed that the people of Israel, when they went into the temple during this camping festival, they would sing. Remember, it says a song. They would sing Psalm 67 as they went into the temple. Psalm 67, a camping psalm, giving thanks to God for the harvest. And then, as you've noticed when we read Psalm 67, asking for God's blessing. Asking for more blessing. God has already blessed them with the harvest, the most important point of the year, enough food for the next. And now they're asking for more blessing. So this morning, for a few minutes, as we look at Psalm 67, I'd like for us to keep this question in mind. What is the meaning, what is the purpose of asking for blessing in Psalm 67 and in our own lives? Psalm 67, verse 1 goes like this. May God be gracious to us and bless us and make his face shine upon us. Do these words seem familiar? Do they ring up any echoes of other passages of Scripture? They should. This is almost a direct quote of Numbers chapter 6, verses 24 through 26. Oftentimes at the end of the service, a pastor will give a blessing before the congregation leaves the sanctuary using this blessing, Aaron's blessing. Remember, God gives this blessing to Moses and says, give it to Aaron, give it to the Levites, give it to the priests. It's a blessing from me to my people, Israel. And what is this blessing? The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. The opening of Psalm 67 is almost a direct quote of Numbers chapter 6, verse 24. And what it declares is God wants to bless his people. That's the basis. That's the basis for asking God's blessing, is he wants to bless his people. There's almost a direct connection between Psalm 67 and Numbers chapter 6, verse 24, but there are two other blessing passages that I'd like to mention this morning in the context of Psalm 67. The first passage is Exodus chapter 19, verses 5 and 6. Do you remember the context of this passage? People of Israel have left Egypt. They're now at Sinai. This is really the day before they receive the 10 words, before God gives them the 10 commandments. And in preparation for receiving those words, they have a kind of worship service, a kind of recommitment service. And God speaks these words to his people at Sinai. Now, if you obey me fully and keep my covenant, then out of all nations you will be my treasured possession. And although the whole earth is mine, you will be for me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. Not quite as direct as Numbers chapter 6, verse 24, but the same idea here. God wants to bless his people. He wants to make them a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. God wants to bless his people. I think there's one thing we should know here. It looks a little bit like quid pro quid. You know, if you do this, I'll do that. That's not really the right way to look at God's blessing, his promise of blessing here. It's more like this. I will bless you, and in response, I want you to keep covenant. I want you to keep your promises towards me. But the bottom line then again, just like in Psalm 67, just like in Numbers chapter 6, verse 24, God wants to bless his people. Then the last passage I want to look at this morning in connection with Psalm 67 is found in Genesis chapter 12, the verses 2 through 3. Do you remember the context of this passage? This is one of the key passages in the entire Old Testament. This is Abram's call. Remember, Abram is called from Ur of the Chaldees, the land of his fathers, to go to a place, a land flowing with milk and honey that God wants to give Abram and his descendants. Listen to what God says. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make you a blessing. God wants to bless his people. We see that in Psalm 67, a response to God's blessing, but we also see a call, a request, a supplication, a petition on the part of God's people asking for more blessing. So that brings us back to our original question. What is the meaning? What is the purpose of asking for God's blessing? Some years ago, when our daughter was in high school, she wanted to sing in the youth choir, the youth chorus there in Grand Rapids. She was a new driver. She'd just gotten her driver's license and driving over to the concert or the choir practice venue involved going on a very busy street. Not as busy as you have around here, the 401 and all that kind of stuff, but it was, for Grand Rapids, a very busy road. And we were just a bit nervous about it. So I don't remember how we did it, but it fell to me to take our daughter Chloe every Monday night to choir practice. We'd get into the car at 5:30. I'd drop her off at 6. I'd drive home. I'd spend a few minutes at home, get back into the car, and drive back. I did that probably just one time, realizing that was not the best use of my time. So I discovered close to the practice venue, I discovered a large grocery store, and worked out great. I drop Chloe off, I go to the grocery store, do a little shopping, have a cup of coffee. It was a great way to redeem the time, so to speak. Remember when I went to that grocery store the first time, remember going in the main entrance, and just off to the side there was a large bookcase, a display case, displaying the books of a kind of famous American pastor, not Canadian, an American pastor. And right in the very center of this display was a picture of this pastor. I'm not going to say his name to you this morning, but I could describe him just a little bit. Youthful, athletic looking, expensive suit and tie, very expensive looking haircut, white, straight, shiny teeth. He looked great in that picture. I'm not going to describe, I'm not going to tell you the name of this pastor this morning. And to be, in all fairness, I haven't read his books. I never bought one of his books. But my impression of this pastor's ministry is this. The pastor's ministry is all about blessing. It's all about asking God for blessing. And it seems it's sort of like this. God, bless me with wealth. God, bless me with health. God, bless me so that my life and the life of my family prospers and goes smoothly. I'm not going to say the name of this pastor this morning. And in all fairness, he's not the only one in America or perhaps in Canada or around the world who has a ministry about blessing. God, bless me. But back to our question of Psalm 67, the people of Israel are asking for blessing. Is that the purpose, the meaning of their asking for blessing? God bless us with health, wealth, and things go smoothly. If that's the meaning of blessing and asking for blessing in Psalm 67, if it's about me, finally, ultimately, only, blessing doesn't mean very much. No, that's not the meaning of asking for blessing in Psalm 67. We can say, in a word, asking for blessing in Psalm 67 is this: blessed to be a blessing. That's the meaning of Psalm 67. In fact, that's the meaning of every single passage I've already read to you this morning. Think back to the call of Abram. It says, I will make you into a great nation and I will bless you. I will make your name great. And, purpose clause, you will be a blessing. And all the peoples on earth will be blessed through you. God wants to bless Abram, changes his name to Abraham, father of many nations. God wants to bless Abraham. And we should note here, it's not because Abraham is such a great guy. We see almost immediately he has some truth-telling issues. He also has some family dysfunction. God doesn't choose him because he's such a great guy. God chooses Abram and changes his name to Abraham, father of the nations, so that Abraham and his descendants can be a blessing to all the nations of the earth. The same thing is true of Exodus chapter 19. And in fact, we can see a fulfillment of Exodus chapter 19, verses 5 and 6, in reading 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 9 and 10. Listen to what Peter says about the people of the promise, Abraham's descendants, the new Israel, the church. Listen to what Peter says. But you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God, so that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. Once again, blessed to be a blessing, to share God's love and his mercy with the nations. This goes back, this connection between these three passages Numbers chapter 6, verses 24 through 26, ties back into Psalm 67. And I'll just say this too. I keep saying almost direct quote. Did you notice the difference between Numbers chapter 6, 24 through 26 and Psalm 67? Psalm 67 says, may God be gracious to us and bless us. Exodus chapter 6, verse 24 says, may the Lord bless us and keep us. So the difference is between Psalm 67 and number 6, the name for God. Same God, but different name used by the authors. So what are we talking about here? When we're talking about Numbers chapter 6, verses 24 through 26, the blessing that God gives for his people, his name is Lord. Are you familiar with that Hebrew convention? Lord is Adonai. The reason that they used Lord, they didn't want to take God's name in vain, so they said Adonai. What stands behind Adonai? The name that God gives to Moses at the burning bush in Exodus chapter 3. Remember, God says, when Moses asked, whom shall I say sent me? Whom shall I say sent me? And God says, I am who I am. The Hebrew name for I am who I am, as you probably know, is Yahweh. Sometimes we say Jehovah. The people of Israel didn't want to say that. They said Adonai, but it means the covenant-keeping God. So whenever you see Lord with all caps in the Old Testament, Adonai, it stands for Yahweh. It stands for Jehovah. It stands for God speaking directly to his people. It's like private conversation. But that's not what takes place in Psalm 67. May God be gracious to us and bless us. God here, the Hebrew name is El or Elohim, and it stands for God's mighty power over all of creation, his mighty power over all of the nations. Right there, that's a hint that Psalm 67 is not only for the people of Israel, it is for all of the ethnos, the nations, the peoples on the earth. Not universal in the sense of salvation, but universal in the sense of God wanting to bless the nations, the peoples of the earth. We can see this also in the very structure of Psalm 67. I'm not sure if you noticed this. There's a kind of interesting Hebrew, sort of rhetorical device at the center of Psalm 67. The very center of most Psalms is the main point. And we have that here in Psalm 67, and it's emphasized by a refrain that repeats itself in verse 3 and verse 5. It says in verse 3, may the peoples praise you, O God. May all the peoples praise you. And then it says again in verse 5, may the peoples praise you, O God. May all the peoples praise you. What the author is saying is right there at the very center is the point of the song. And what does it say? Verse 4, may the nations be glad and sing for joy, for you rule the peoples justly and guide the nations of the earth. Let me summarize then again. Psalm 67 is a harvest festival. It's a camping psalm. People of Israel, they would go up to the temple. They would sing this song. They would give thanks and praise for God's provision. And then they would ask for more blessing. Not for blessing to stop with them, but blessed to be a blessing. That's the biblical meaning of being blessed. Blessed to be a blessing. So good to be here this morning, to see your cheerful faces, to see the vibrancy, to hear it in your singing, to see it in your worship. So good to be here this morning. And I can say without a doubt, I thank God has blessed you. I think that God has blessed you. What do you think? It's important to note here, blessing doesn't mean always health, wealth, and smooth going of your life. Sometimes we don't fully understand the scope of blessing. That's not what it means to have things go easy. Just ask yourself this morning, maybe think about it later today too, has God blessed me? How has God blessed me? And then let the words of Psalm 67, it's not a quote here, but the meaning, let these words ring to the depths of your heart. Blessed to be a blessing. And then offer this little prayer. God, you have blessed me. How can I bless those around me? As I was working on Psalm 67, I developed an earworm. Have you ever developed an earworm? Earworm is the kind of thing where a phrase from a song gets in your head and you can't get rid of it, and it's going over and over and it drives you crazy. I don't know. I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand. I have these things occasionally and it drives me crazy. And so when I was working on Psalm 67, I developed an earworm, and I figured out by looking at the internet there's a way to get rid of earworms. It doesn't always work for me, but they say that if you look at the whole song and try to, you know, not just one phrase, but the whole song, and try to do the whole song, eventually, you know, the earworm will go away. So I did that. I was had this song going through my head and looked up the words of the song. I don't know, can you guess the song I was having going through my head? It wasn't, Lord, make me a blessing, although that would have been a great song to have going through my head. It's a different song, a song that we used to sing when I was a boy. Showers of Blessing. Have you heard that song? We used to sing it. It doesn't seem like we sing it very often anymore. That phrase was going through my head. There shall be showers of blessing. So I took the, you know, internet advice, and I looked up all the words, and I read through them, all the verses. And if I'm honest, I have to say some of the theology in the song seemed a little bit suspect to me. But there's one thing that this song nails. The first line of the first verse goes like this. There shall be showers of blessing. The last line of the first stanza goes just like this. Sent from the Savior above. Sisters and brothers, if we leave Psalm 67 without talking about that Savior above, we've missed God's greatest, most expansive, most wonderful, most sublime blessing of all. Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. He is the blessing that's spoken about from Genesis through Revelation. He is the blessing that is the foundation of everything related to creation. He is the Lord of our hearts. He is the blessing. And He's blessed us. Doesn't mean things will always be easy. He's blessed us to be a blessing. How will each one of us, reflecting on God's blessing, be a blessing to those around us? Amen. And as the worship team comes to the front, I invite you all to stand, if you're able, to sing together, All Creatures of Our God and King.
Good morning. We're going to do our congregational prayer, and I just wanted to share one prayer request that came in after the beacon was sent out, so just so there's no confusion why I'm mentioning them. We're grieving right now with Evelyn Hurt and Dave. Unfortunately, her brother passed away quite unexpectedly, so if you could please hold them in your prayers this week as well. Let's all go together in a time of prayer. Our great Heavenly Father, thank you for providing this time today to commune with you, to humbly bring you our praise and adoration, as imperfect as we may be. We serve an almighty God, an omnipotent God, an all-powerful God, and I'd be lying if I said I grasped those concepts 100%. But even as we grapple and sometimes doubt and get confused, you are steady and perfect and always present. So thank you for still loving us, God, and spending time with us. 1 Peter 5, verses 6 and 7 says, "Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that at the proper time he may exalt you, casting all your anxieties on him, because he cares for you." How beautiful it is that we are called to cast all our anxieties on you, God, in the same breath that we are called to also humble ourselves before you. We have to let go of pride. We have to let go of the drive to control everything in our lives, and we must throw ourselves at the mercy of an infinitely bigger God. But this is not a gamble, and it is not a risk. It is a gain. It is having our greatest weaknesses transformed into displays of your perfect provision. It may be a daily struggle to humble ourselves, but we ask that you help us, God. We ask that we feel that call and the absolute need to surrender in our lives to you. Laying all our insecurities and worries before you, Lord, there is nowhere else to go, and there's no one else we need to go to. It is to you, God, that we offer up all our anxieties. We hold out our hands and we bear all the concern we have for our brothers and sisters in this church who need healing and comfort. We give up the worry, the anger, the fear and indifference, and whatever human tendencies creep up in our hearts. And instead we pray with love and peace and patience over Lori, Helena, Sid, Alice, Tom, Evelyn, and everyone else in this church who needs it. We also hold out our hands to you as we ask for your will and way to be known in this stage with Pastor Craig. We pray for clear direction for him, Janine, and their sons, and we pray for joy and peace in the process of discerning your call for them. Again, we give up fear and worry, and instead we praise you that we get to be actively working with you to discover a pastor for our church. We are not alone, and we have never been alone in this journey. You have a beautiful plan for our church and beyond, and we say thank you for using us as Bethel as you see fit. Your will be done, Lord, on earth as it is in heaven. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Please stand if you're able to receive God's parting blessing. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with each and every one of us, now and forevermore. Amen.